I'm Hari Srinivasan, live here at the RNC, and you've heard a lot about how social media is impacting the election cycle. Here to tell us a little bit more of that, Adam Sharp from Twitter. Okay, so we know that sentiment changes very quickly, and we would expect that the RNC probably generates some buzz for Romney. How do you measure that on Twitter?
Well, we've been operating the last few months something we call the Twitter Political Index. This is a daily measurement of Twitter users' attitudes towards the candidates as expressed by their tweets. So if we're looking at today's numbers, for example, President Obama is at 28, Governor Romney is at 40. Now, these numbers translate into essentially where the average tweet about the candidates falls on the spectrum of conversation on Twitter. So numbers below 50 means they are among the more negatively viewed things on Twitter. Numbers above 50 mean they're among the more positively viewed things on Twitter. So right now, the conversation about the campaign overall is slightly negative. Both candidates are below 50, but when you look at Governor Romney, he's a little bit higher than President Obama right now, as he has been about 40% of the time since we started tracking this on May 1st.
Okay, so let's look a little bit at that historical data. And what does that show us? And we see this entire timeline sort of May 1 all the way to August. Is there a way that you can see certain spikes and what the news event was that made that spike?
Yes, so from May 1st to today, August 28th, we have seen this as Governor Romney ahead about 40% of the time, the president ahead about 60% of the time. It averages out to about a 3-point lead for the president over this time period. But it has varied day to day. If we go back to early May, right here for these spikes, up for President Obama, down for Governor Romney, this was the day of the president's announcement of his support for gay marriage. Here, most of the conversation was on the pro-Obama side. You saw a big boost for the president and a drop-off for Governor Romney. But fast forward to the end of June, and the Supreme Court decision on healthcare, you see a slightly different effect. A big spike for President Obama when Obamacare was essentially upheld, but you also saw an increase for Governor Romney on that day, which tells us there was vibrant conversation on both sides of the issue supporting their candidate's position. Moving forward again to late July, early August, here's where we saw something else interesting go on. President Obama spent a week talking mostly about the Olympics. He was exchanging tweets with swimmer Michael Phelps, with the women's U.S. gymnastics team. Governor Romney was traveling overseas, first in London for the opening ceremonies, then on to Poland, then to Israel. So you had this week where the president was not focused on politics, and his opponent was not in the United States campaigning at the time. And so you saw this slow build for the president, while Governor Romney stayed relatively flat, also built a little bit, culminating on the president's birthday. It's hard to get better sentiment than happy birthday from a few hundred thousand people on Twitter. When birthday weekend was over, Olympics were over, Governor Romney came back to the U.S. and we went back into traditional campaign mode on both sides.
Yep.
Both numbers dropped until the following weekend when Governor Romney announced Paul Ryan as his running mate, when Governor Romney saw a boost quickly overtaken by President Obama in the next few days.
Yep.
But since late last week, we've been seeing Governor Romney slowly and steadily on the increase and having the higher sentiment on Twitter as we head into this convention.
Okay, and then a lot of folks wonder, okay, how realistic is this? How does Twitter, is Twitter a good measure of sentiment in the same way polling does now?
Well, it's important to recognize that we are not trying to replace traditional polling. The same way that radar and satellite did not replace the thermometer and barometer, but gave us a more complete picture of the weather forecast, that's what we're hoping to do here. Realizing that sometimes what you tell a pollster when they call at the dinner hour is not the same as the natural conversation you're having with your friends and your coworkers at the coffee shop or the water cooler.
Right.
And we can now, for the first time, measure those conversations because they've been brought out into this public space and this public square on Twitter.
Okay, and let's take a quick look at the Ryan factor if we can too. I think the one right before that. Yeah. So now, did Paul Ryan go viral on Twitter before people knew that he was the VP pick?
Yes. In fact, this is a measure of tweets per minute from late night on August 10th, a Friday night, to Saturday, August 11th, the formal announcement. And you see, in the hours leading up to 11 o'clock, 9 to 11 p.m., there was essentially no activity. There was a couple of tweets here and there about Paul Ryan, but no real measurable volume. Then at 11:06, the Romney campaign communications director announced that there would be an event on Saturday to name the VP pick.
Right.
Right off the bat, speculation starts to build. Paul Ryan is talked about more and more. until 12:01 a.m. when NBC News was the first to report that Ryan was in fact a fair. We see another big spike there. At this point, it's well into the late night hours on the East Coast, so it doesn't get much higher than 865 tweets per minute a little after 1 a.m. Drops off. Then the next morning, the official announcement comes via the Romney campaign iPhone app at 7 a.m. and actually hits its peak at 9:29, the moment Paul Ryan walks out on stage in Norfolk, Virginia. 3,749 tweets in a single minute talking about Paul Ryan at that point, peaking again a little bit later in Paul Ryan's speech in reaction to the line, "No duck the tough issues we lead."
Okay, so in the big picture, what is Twitter able to do and show us now about how the political conversation in America is happening?
Well, it gives us a more complete picture, and this actually, as I said before, doesn't replace polling, it makes it stronger. The same way as in the weather tools, when all the dials point the same way, we have a very strong picture of the weather forecast, but when they don't, we dig deeper. Now we can do the same thing here. When all the dials point the same direction, that gives us more confidence in what the polling is telling us, what the focus groups are telling us. But when the dials go in different directions, when the poll is telling us one thing, when people are telling that person who calls at the dinner hour one thing, but then the next day are going into the office, gathering around the water cooler, and telling their colleagues something else, that tells us that there's something more complex going on in the electorate and allows us to dig deeper, and we're fortunate enough that we can actually look at the tweets themselves. And this couldn't be possible if it wasn't for the sheer volume of conversation to begin with. There are 400 million tweets each and every day today. Compare that to 2008, where by election day, there had only been 800 million tweets ever, and Twitter was a 2.5-year-old company. So we are seeing more tweets every 2 days than we had ever seen prior to the 2008 election.
Adam Sharp from Twitter, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Stay with us. We'll have more from the RNC, and we'll have more updates throughout the day, as well as some other videos in the stream. So I'm Hari Srinivasan from the NewsHour. Stay with us.